The idea is that right now we're going to spend like 15 minutes in which I myself explain you in a nutshell what has been happening in Barcelona the last 2 years and a bit more than this. Then Q&A, doubts, concerns, I all can also help you guys with, you know, all the, any concepts you might have. And then we'll have like 30 minutes for workshop proper, talking groups and that kind of thing, so you don't get bored as a result. Well, so I wanted to get this slide. I'm not going to run the video because otherwise we will lose time, but because I think it's important as a symbol. Because this story goes back quite some years in time. To two things in particular. More or less 2007, the housing bubble explodes. A good part of Europe enters into the crisis that is still suffering. Thousands, millions of citizens in Spain that felt like, okay, we were middle class, we had our houses, that is over. They are no longer middle class, and they no longer have houses in poverty. That's one day. The other one, 15 May 2011. You might have heard about the so-called indignados. These people that met in the squares, protesting because they felt that the political parties, the traditional political parties, were absolutely incapable of delivering precisely a response to the penalties they were suffering. These 2 days, let's say, provided the moment, provided the foundations of this story about someone to have. Well, to begin with, you might have heard about these people, of the anti-evictions platform, the Plataforma de Factores por la Hipoteca. All these people, were, many of them actually were people that had their houses back in the days. Or that, you know, they had a mortgage and they were expecting to become proprietors of their own houses. They lost all this. But instead of, you know, trying to survive, in whatever possible way, they started to organize in a grassroots fashion, meeting, sharing concerns, and starting actions to reclaim their right to have a decent house, right? So that was one very significant part of these grassroots foundations of Barcelona. The other one is all these people from the Indignados that at the beginning they felt, well, okay, we are not reaching something in particular, but then they started to organize, self-organize, like in a bottom-up fashion, around concrete topics. For example, right to water, right to not live in energy poverty, for example. So they, we could see all these people like 2013, 14, fighting in their separate struggles. Achieving victory sometimes, but facing a considerable obstacle, which was that, I mean, if you are not in the moderation of political institutions, there are many things you cannot do, because the so-called, you know, traditional politicians will always find ways to counteract your different campaigns. So, these people thought, okay, perhaps we have a chance, we stand a chance in Barcelona. And there was, in Barcelona, there was indeed the foundations for this. PAU was strong, so the anti-eviction platform was strong. Indignados were strong. And there were also many, many, many social activists with their separate struggles, neighborhood leaders, neighborhood movements, associations. And, you know, they all shared common, concrete concerns. I'm going to be working during this meeting, I'm going to be working with this idea of the concrete concerns because it's absolutely fundamental to our project. So they thought, why not unite based on this concrete concerns? Let's build something in common based on this, step by step. And so, because of this, and because there was in 2015 the municipal elections would come, there was the idea that perhaps based on these concrete things we can actually create a political platform that can run the elections and who knows if even win the municipal. That was called initially Guanya. Then the name for long story, no change to Barcelona. So which were the, let's say, the building pieces, the building part, the main parts of this whole edifice of Barcelona Comú. First of all, the power of concreteness. We spend no time in talking about, you know, like the traditional left about complex concepts like working class, the class struggle, blah, 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 blah. No, because many of the people that has lost everything, they need a concrete solution to their concrete problems. So we basically build on this all the time. And it's, well, I don't know so much about Denmark, but in our context, this has been working pretty well, because then you can reach the attention of the people that is listening to you. So that was one element. And then the other one, of course, is, yeah, sure, you can be concrete, but if you are not if you are not providing people the tools for their own empowerment, if they cannot get an ownership of what's going on, if they are just, you know, spectators, they won't think what those people. They won't be part of the project, and this is a very poor understanding of democracy, because we didn't want, like, the old representative system in which citizens are just voters / spectators, and then politicians are something else. No, we want to be in and out to disappear. That's like, we stand in equal chance. So, in order to do all this, that meant that, among many other things, that meant that the electoral program wouldn't be just, you know, something already written and then you buy it. No. Instead, the very citizens, through workshops like this, and online workshops, could start offering their, presenting their concerns. They will start, you know, discussing, okay, so in this neighborhood, we need this and this and this. We need to attend these necessities. Then we will talk with other people on this, on these concrete necessities. And all these different needs will be gathered in the project. So de facto we can say that the electoral program with which Barcelona Comú competed in the elections was basically a citizens program. Citizens made this, this program through in the street neighborhoods, literally in the squares. It just is a beautiful area. But in the same principle applies for everything. Both the people leading the organization, all of them voted, anybody could present him or herself. Also for the funding, microlending, different sources of microlending. The ethical code that ensures that, that our mayor is not going to end a tremendous amount of money when in the municipality, but actually she ends a little bit more than 2,000 euros because of this ethical code that ensures that she's not going to live in conditions different than those of the rest of citizens. So, to everything. That's the video. More or less, this is the idea. You're going to see that because for some reason, all these amounts, one concept which is called the confluence. Our organization is not a political party in the traditional sense of the word, but it's rather a collection of activists, neighborhood leaders, people from different organizations, like the one you mentioned before, that are together for a set of concrete struggles. And if somebody came from there's a very detailed example. At the beginning, there was people that came from one left political party saying, okay, I come from this left political party. The rest of the Barcelona community members will tell this individual, no, you don't come from this organization. You are part of Barcelona community. That's fundamental, because else you don't create this common identity. It becomes just another coalition, and it's part of the same of always. So, common identity, common goals, that's one of the elements. Also, and this comes, these are the parts of the same story. because the this is actually connected with the way we understand feminism, which is it's far more than just gender balance or policies aimed at work-life conciliation, which are fantastic. I mean, I'm not going to I fully support them, but it's actually about having a different approach to politics in general, one that is based on listening, understanding, empathy, putting yourself in the side of the other person you're talking with, providing time for everybody to express, avoiding confrontation, this language of balance, like we are going to solve the power and we are going to overthrow the tyrants. I mean, sure, I don't deny that that has been attractive, but many people actually, or so we believe, wants to built on a more constructive manner. So that's part of our understanding of our particular understanding of feminism. And all this amounts to something called municipalism, or our definition of municipalism. Many of the elements I have already mentioned there. But if you realize, if you have just by listening at our experience or other experience or similar experiences worldwide, these are all bottom-up projects built by people from the neighborhoods based on concrete topics and from their own cities. This is not an organization that on a top-down manner tries to create, let's say, a franchise. Let's put a franchise of our organization here and hope for the best that if that somehow people support this franchise. No. This is actually bottom-up process. So all these different initiatives have been working like this, and ours is no exception. At the same time, we are not just closed in our, let's say, cocoon of Barcelona, but instead our understanding of municipalism is tremendously international. I mean, to begin with, in June we hosted an event with 180 other projects like ours worldwide, I'm actually here talking with you guys. Well, I could be doing something else. So why do we do all these things? Because we believe that this capacity to gather the different municipal projects and for example, launch common campaigns or learn from each other experiences is what can eventually it has the potential of being a force that counteracts the limitations of states. Because sometimes the states, they are trapped in their cocoon of representative, so-called representative democracy, and when it comes to listening people's concerns, they might not be the most effective ones. So we believe that it can be an interesting balance towards this, against these limitations. Examples, climate change, refugees, we are seeing it every single day. And this is a bet. This is a long-term bet. We don't know how far we will reach. But we believe that if we keep growing, like we have been growing so far, not just Barcelona, all countries worldwide, we'll be able to push the states to get a different attitude, for example, towards refugees or towards climate change. Yeah. So based on this experience, you municipality, and then you will wonder, okay. So you need a municipality. What do you do? We face many challenges. We face the tremendous transatlantic. Barcelona is the second biggest municipality in Spain. So you can imagine that it has a pretty sizable bureaucracy with their own ways of doing. Mechanisms, and then you have to change it. No easy task, but luckily, because we were recounted with the support of all these organizations, anti-vixels platforms, neighborhood groups, all these social activists that were in the organization, but also outside the organization, we could also, we can, with their support, to keep pressing and ensure that once we were in the municipality, we just didn't forget our mission, but we kept transforming the municipality. In many ways, we have been transforming. I'm gonna, you know, ask you, but otherwise, it's coming in a little bit more. The same concept of democracy, of radical democracy, we applied when creating the organization and the political program and everything. We also have been applying in the making of municipal policies. So, for example, we, as you might have heard, we face a tremendous problem called massive tourism and gentrification in Barcelona, right? That is literally expelling neighbors from their neighborhoods in the center of the town. So one way of doing this was one way of tackling this challenge has been to set a plan that limits the number of tourist dwellings in the center of the town. Instead of doing it in a top-down manner, like people in the municipality imposing it on all the town, this has been in different workshops, online participation tools have been employed to gather the consent of the people and say, okay, so we have to define the zones in this way or in this order. So the plan that has been finally approved is one that comes with a considerable popular support, and it's working for now. Same for the general plan that regulates how consultation is applied in every single policy. And another anecdote, but it's quite significant. Back in, before we arrived, nobody knew what was the agenda of the mayor, or the district councils, or the municipality council. So they could travel in it with, I don't know, somebody working for a business, for some business lobby, and nobody would know about that. After we arrived, one goal we have been applying is all the agendas are published online. So everybody knows who is other meeting with, who is this district council meeting with. All the kind of things are available online. And many more at times. Other things. Because most of our people is dispossessed in the way that they might face energy poverty, for example, if they have no jobs, or one of these absolutely high jobs. One thing that we believe is that people has the right to access to affordable energy. Energy that they can pay according to the price. Because of this, we planning of end of next year, we are also a municipal energy company. Still, the reach is limited, but eventually it might reach more than these 20,000 families, because we are playing a little bit with the law. That's, by the way, that's an interesting example of these challenges. The Spanish law, the government, state level law, sets a limitation that the energy that the municipalities through their public enterprises can produce, only 20% of it can go to citizens, can be offered to citizens. We have this limitation, and before anything changes in the state level law, one way to work with this is make sure that more municipal companies start buying this energy, and therefore you increase the total electricity pool so that more families can reach. That was an example. Oh, another challenge. We also want to re-municipalize water, because water was private. It was privatized back in the days, and still, and it's one of these businesses owned by these tremendously large multinational companies. We are working on it, and precisely one of the limitations is that these things go through super long core processes. So, basically, it's one of these battles that you can have to it until they fall down. Another interesting thing, housing. Again, as you will remember that anti-evictions platform is a fundamental basic foundation for our organization. So one of the first things was, okay, we arrived in the municipality and we see, as we know well, that previous government, municipal governments, have done practically nothing to provide social housing, any kind of social housing to the citizens. So that's one big challenge that we are indeed facing. There was no, I mean, there was 10,000 apartments, which for a city of 1.5 million citizens, you might imagine, is perhaps a little bit small, especially given the circumstances. So the current, you know, what we are doing right now is basically tripling total number. Slow, it's in a slow process, and probably it's not enough. Actually, that's also a very nice example, because the anti-evictions platform, because they are in the municipality, but also out, they are running campaigns, putting pressure on us, telling us that we are not doing enough. That's another nice example of how we combine this in and out the municipality thing, so that we keep ambitious, right? Yeah, that will be an example of this. And then also another challenge, refugees. We really want to be a city open to refugees and all these people that is basically running out of their home houses. But of course, state level regulations, state policy, difficult to get the doors open. So, apart from running routine campaigns to come to showing to the public that these people is not the state level is not doing their job, we are also providing help in-house, retail, to the NGOs that are working in Greece to attend the people that has this running out of work. There is living in their own cabins. Yeah. And I'm going to finish with this, otherwise I have time for anything. We have many other examples. For example, we are trying, again, related with housing, we are starting something that didn't exist before, which was this co-housing model. I mean, you guys, one thing that really interests me, that really elicits my curiosity of Denmark, is this whole Andel model of co-housing that has its upsides and everything. Because we believe that in Barcelona, probably implemented by different organizations of grassroots level, it could be a quick way, it could be an interesting way of providing social housing that people really need. So, we are starting to offer different land plots for these cooperatives to start their own projects. Challenges, well, again, social economy is a whole sector that still needs quite some development. But basically, it's a thing with municipalism. Either you are persistent long term, or you just don't succeed. And we have to keep persistent. So that's all for now, and then, yeah, we're going to